Welcome to our book club. You voted on what book for me to read and summarize, and this book got votes. Hi, I'm Dr. Teresa Lyons. I teach parents the cutting-edge scientific information of autism so that you can make the best decision for your child based on quality information. This is the second part of book club for this book. I broke it into two videos because the vagus nerve is very important. In the first video, I went over what the vagus nerve is and discussed the physical observables there are if someone has issues with their vagus nerve. We focused on behaviors, digestion, the big autism observables. There's a link down below if you want to watch the first video based on this book. In this video right now, the second video, I'll go over how to measure vagus nerve functioning. Yes, measure. That way, when you do exercises, you can actually measure your improvement. Really important to do. So this book has some great exercises to strengthen the vagus nerve, and it's all about improving vagus nerve function and quantifying that improvement. I'll list them out so you can ask your child's therapist to do them or add them to your child's IEP as goals. Anyone can benefit from doing these exercises, so you could even do it with your child if you wanted to, but you don't have to. You certainly can have these exercises done by somebody else with your child. Let me go get my slides so that if you are a visual learner, you can see what I'm talking about. And if you found this video to be helpful, please hit the like button and also subscribe to my channel to get the cutting edge scientific information about autism so that you can make the best decision for your child based on quality information.
Let's learn about activating your vagus nerve. Measuring vagus nerve functioning. This is important to do firsthand, right? Because if you want to activate it, you want to know how was it functioning before you did different exercises. So very important to quantify. And there are four methods to measure vagus nerve function. Heart rate variability, heart rate, breath pattern, and bowel transit time. The book goes into detail about all of that, so if you're interested in the details on how to do that, certainly I recommend the book. Exercises to activate vagus nerve. Breathing exercises, sleeping on your side, periodic cold exposure. One of the examples was when you finish taking your shower, just have a minute or two of really cold water, and that actually activates your vagus nerve. Humming or chanting, activating the gag reflex, gargling, yoga, meditation, sunlight exposure, coffee enemas, and supplements. The book recommended these two, omega-3 fatty acids and 5-HTP. The book goes into detail for all of that, so if you're interested in seeing what kind of exercises maybe you can do or your child can do, certainly purchase the book. Now, if you have a child who is young or maybe someone who doesn't follow directions very easily, then there are passive ways to activate your vagus nerve. Acupuncture, massage, reflexology, visceral manipulation, chiropractic care, and electrical stimulation. Those are all passive ways to activate the vagus nerve. Let's get into some common questions. These are not really addressed in the book, but since we're talking about the vagus nerve, let's just get into these common questions. How do you activate the vagus nerve in a child? So use a combination of exercises and passive ways. You certainly can figure out what is the best combination based upon the functioning of your child. There's always a way, and there certainly is, and it's great that there's passive ways. What is vagus nerve stimulation for autism? Vagus nerve stimulation is approved for use in the treatment of epilepsy, depression, headaches, migraines, stroke. It is not approved for autism. It's just important to get that fact first. There is some evidence in the scientific literature that vagus nerve stimulation when performed for epilepsy may improve behavior in people with autism. There are indications that this occurs independently of its effects on seizure frequency and mood. So therefore, obviously, more rigorous studies are required. So there's just a little bit of evidence showing this. There's not a lot of research, and obviously, it is not FDA approved for autism. What are the risks of vagus nerve stimulation? It depends. So there is a vagus nerve stimulation that requires surgical implantation. So obviously those risks are much, much higher. And there's now a non-invasive vagus nerve stimulator. It's called gammaCore. And that's FDA approved for headaches and migraines. It is prescription only, so you would need your healthcare provider to be involved and to prescribe gammaCore. What part of the nervous system does autism affect? In autism, the nervous system can be impacted differently depending on the person, depending on the symptoms that they're experiencing. There's no uniformity for everyone with autism as to how the nervous system might be impacted. This is really, for many people, what presents a challenge. Is that there's no just universal, okay, just do this and you'll get that. That's not the case in autism. The vagus nerve has many functions, so it is possible for one person with autism to experience things differently than another person with autism who has different vagus nerve health challenges. I think that's abundantly clear in the part one video where it explains all the different functions of the vagus nerve. There's so many. And just if you have a vagus nerve that's not performing optimally, doesn't mean that all of the functions will not perform optimally. So you can have a lot of variability in that situation. This is a question that can only be answered individually while working with a knowledgeable healthcare provider. You certainly can answer this question for the individual person, but you need to be working with someone who's knowledgeable. Can vagus nerve stimulation improve social cognition in autism? There is some evidence that the vagus nerve stimulation, when performed for epilepsy, like I just talked about a few moments ago, that may improve behavior in people with autism, but it's just a small publication. There's indications that this occurs independently of effects on seizure frequency and mood, but again, more studies are needed. This is not an answer that has been resolved in the scientific literature as of yet. Some parents are trying vagus nerve stimulation, but again, there's not a large amount of published scientific research in autism and vagus nerve stimulation. Does the vagus nerve affect speech? Vagus nerve stimulation does not have enough research into autism to quantify any of these impacts. So you might hear an anecdotal story of someone whose speech has really improved, and maybe that was due to the vagus nerve and the swallowing, right? Because when you're talking, you have to swallow. So there's many different ways where vagus nerve can change how someone is flowing through life. But again, there's not enough research into autism and the vagus nerve to quantify this effect. Here's a quote from a publication. Vagus nerve stimulation paired with behavioral therapy may represent a potential new approach to enhance rehabilitation that could significantly improve the outcomes of individuals with neurodevelopmental disorders. There's the reference there. So they're still in that may space. There's no hard evidence either way, right? So it's not as if the vagus nerve stimulation will cause great harm for the most part, but there's no hard evidence saying that it's really beneficial. So please work with a knowledgeable healthcare provider. What foods heal the vagus nerve? This question is actually addressed in the book. The author recommends organic, locally grown fruits and vegetables, lean free-range chicken and eggs, lean grass-fed and grass-finished beef, non-GMO grains like rice and quinoa, organic nuts and seeds. The author also recommends intermittent fasting so that the vagus nerve has time to rest. There are some children with autism who select themselves to do fasting. And sometimes this causes great worry for the parents. Many times it's beneficial. You really want to work with your child and build that partnership so that the two of you can trust each other. Because if they're saying, listen, I really just don't want to eat right now, they might feel a lot better. And it might have something to do with giving the vagus nerve time to rest. So there's a lot of different possibilities. You want to work with your child as much as possible so that they're involved in getting to be healthier and happier. For fasting, also please speak with a knowledgeable healthcare provider. And here are some references.